welcome and very good morning. Alhamdulillah, thank you very much. Organizing this conference. And, welcome to Malaysia for those who are first time here. It's an honor to be one of the chairmen together with this conference. We have one last year in Dubai. This is the first one in Malaysia. And then we have the second month, the ICGET in Denmark this year. So I know everybody, all participants, eager to present, just finish off their presentation and finish for the day. Okay. I hope I'll give just a short sharing together. This project is my PhD student. He has completed his working in Iraq now, just to share on LTE. Before that, I'm Muhammad Faiz bin Abdullah. I'm working in University Tun Sri Malaysia. That's our library. We are in Johor, southern region of Malaysia. So it's around 3 hours drive. If you are fast, 2 hours on the high speed train. So it's in the middle before Singapore. I think around 40 minutes to Johor Bahru, Singapore. So if you're welcome, if you want to come and study here. I'm under the faculty of electrical and electronic engineering. And I think today a few of my students, PhD, are also presenting. So what is LTE? Maybe not all of you are in this area. We are all talking about mobile phones. Everybody is using mobile phones, advanced mobile communication phones. Okay, and LTE-A is one of the system that is controlling the mobile communication. At the moment, we are on 4G, but we are moving towards the fifth generation. The one I gave a talk on in Dubai last year on the fifth generation. We are working on it. I'm one of the vice chairman for the sub-working committing group in Malaysia for MCMC. MCMC is a Malaysian commission working on all this mobile communication. So LTE-A, why we use this? Okay, some phone already has LTE-A. If you have the previous generation, then you could not accept an LTE system. Okay. So because one of the system is a high throughput, low latency, and then high speed data. Okay, everybody want data fast. Okay, so that's why we need to move into this LTE device. Okay. And what my student did was to actually improve the spectrum usage efficiency. Okay. Of course, he has not been adopted by LTE yet. What he did was on the frequency in European. Okay. And we try to achieve a high data rates in terms of their transmission. And what we want to do is actually this technique here, we call it a carrier aggregation. Okay. The technique is what we call a carrier aggregation, how we separate the spectrum into each of the channel. Okay. So in the end, what he managed to do was to get a better performance of LTE. Then he managed to get a larger bandwidth, which was increased. What LTE fourth generation did was to get 1 gigabits per second. And what he did was managed to increase the peak data rate to 4 gigabits per second. Okay. And of course, he compared the efficiency between the previous LTE and LTE Advanced. Okay. I think Malaysia have not gone to using LTE Advanced. LTE Advanced is on the release 11.12 of that system. Okay. So I think we are actually using only release 8 or 9, okay? We're a bit slow, okay? Compared to other countries like Japan, Korea, they're much faster with, okay? And of course, he also tried to use this MIMO technology to implement on how many antennas which we can transmit LTE. But unfortunately, he did not build the system, okay? It's more on the modulation system of this project, okay? And in the end, what he managed to do, increase component carrier from 5 to 6, okay? The maximum of the current system is only 5. And then the current system bandwidth is only 100 megahertz, and then he managed to do it until 120 megahertz. Peak data rate, I say 1 gigahertz to 4 gigahertz, and then the boost of the efficiency of the system. So this is the bandwidth of LTE and LTE Advanced, okay? So you can see each of the bandwidth is 20 megahertz, 20 megahertz. Okay. So in the end, they get 100 megahertz of 5 aggregation. Okay. So in the end, what he managed to do is to get from 100 megahertz, he managed to get 120. And then he managed to stack instead of 5 into 6 carry aggregation to the system. Okay. So this carry aggregation principle, okay, you have a few types. Okay, they have this context of carry aggregation. We have the component carrier CC. Okay, that is what we have. Okay, 20 megahertz. You aggregate each of the channel into one by one until 100 megahertz system. Okay. And then under this calibration, they propose two types. Okay, one is the CC to support the LTE, and then one is to support the system. Okay, so when you have 5, you can send in more data, and then many other systems can relate together to the system. Of course, there's a few types of carrier aggregation. Okay, one we call it the intra-band carrier aggregation. That is the CC, and then one is the intra aggregation. One with continuous, which is together, side by side, and then one non-continuous, which means that you separate between two here and then two here. But the, in the end, the system is still the same, 100 megahertz. And then the one with continuous, you manage to send 5, and then the non-continuous, you only manage to send in 4, okay, of the spectrum system. And then one is the intra-band, so you have altogether three types. Okay, inter, you have contiguous and then non-contiguous, and then one in the intra-band, non-contiguous, which is separated into a two-band system. Of course, MIMO, I think everybody have understand the basic system of MIMO. This is where you have one system sending to two or three antenna together, or you have one hand side and then linking into one of the base station together. Okay, so you have two handset, and how do we use the same system and then get two handphone? Now we have so many. Okay, some of my students, even each person have two set of handphone. One they say for personal, and then one for non-personal. Okay, so you can see how many phones they have to meet to be contacted to that base station. Okay. So this is the MIMO presentation, okay, where different data streams fit into the pre-coding operation, and of course this is using the OFDM system. Okay, I'm not going to go into detail the OFDM. So you have the layer, the multiplexer, and then the multiplexer, and then the layer mapping and coding and decoding. Okay. And what did my student did was to look at the downlink access of the LTE system. Done using the OFDMA system. So as I say, the 5 CC 100 megahertz, and then transmit into LTE, LTE and LTE system. Okay. So what he did was, he did an 8x8, okay? I think before the system is only 4x4, okay? By having 8x8 on the downlink, okay? So it's something new compared to previously 4x4. And I think what he did was he add in a few of this CRC insertion on it, and then with the configuration map to communicate between the input and the output of the system. Okay, this is on the receiver side. Okay, so he managed to put in 8 and then transmit, and then on the receive side. Okay. Data aggregation. This figure shows the map of the component carrier for the physical layer. Okay, so. Well, of course, we did not build the physical layer. Okay, this is how it's arranged. If you have the physical layer and you have eight antenna system, then you have to upgrade each one for each of the system. Okay, so each component carrier will send to one of the antenna and then one of the component system. And then this transportation block is using what we call the hybrid automatic repeat curate (HRQ) schedule. For the transmission. Okay. So this is the method of controlling the protocol system between the transmitter and the receiver system. So this is the whole system, okay? Transmitter and receiver together on the system. Okay. This is the proposal and the novelty of his work. And result from that, okay, he did two methods. One, he used a MATLAB, he wrote his program himself. And then one, we managed to get a temporary system because HP actually they have developed, we call it System View, okay? HP have that system which you can use to actually work on LTE system. Unfortunately, the package is very expensive, okay? Because we as a university, we could not afford to buy the system. And they managed to lend us to use that system for 3 months. So we managed to use a MATLAB. He wrote the program and then we compare with the system view. Okay. So this is the channel. Okay, you can see CC1 and CC2. So this is how we integrate the channel between the bandwidth. And then to prove the result, we managed to have that frequency spacing adjust between 300 kHz. And then the practical result are 17.1 MHz. Okay. So this is what they managed to do. This is for LTE advanced downlink for intra-band continuation stuff for bandwidth 40 MHz. That day I presented this to our MCMC, but unfortunately in Malaysia we use 41 MHz. Okay. So the channel for Malaysia is not suitable for this. This is for the European one. So that is LTE advanced downlink, continuous 60 MHz. So we increase the bandwidth, okay, from 40, 60, 80, and you can see how the channel has been segregated from 3 and then become 4. So by 100 MHz, you manage to put in 5. Okay, that is now what you're having in the system for LTE. And then what he did was to do 120 by having 5 MHz. By keeping the same system, quality system, which is able to transmit at 120 MHz. So LTE advanced, okay. So in the end, number of components carrier 2. So we managed to integrate the frequency spacing 33.48 MHz, which leads to around 1160 integrated channel. Okay. So this is the final result of his system. Okay. For intra-band, okay, that one was the inter-band, okay, this is intra-band non-contiguous, but that was contiguous, and this is non-contiguous. You can see non-contiguous, as I told you, is a separate between one channel and next channel. So initially, for 60 MHz, you get 3, 80, you get 4, so 100, 4, so, and then this is the one that he managed to do 5, 6, okay, so this is one for non-contiguous and one for contiguous components. And of course, he also put all those systems into the MIMO that he presented just now, 2x2 and then 8x8. So this is just a throughput output result. Okay. He managed to, what we want is the output, final output 33.6 MHz. Okay. That is comparison with the LTE advanced website system. Okay, so you can see as we move in from 1 to 12, 1 to 6, 1 to 3, so you can see the megahertz start to increase. Okay. This is for 4x4, okay, and then 8x8. So of course, as you go in by a higher MIMO, higher antenna, you get a much higher output throughput frequency for the system. This is for 16 QAM. Okay, he did one for the QAM. So this is for 16 QAM, and you can see the megabits per seconds are all also a difference. Okay. So this is for 16, for 4x4, and then at the end for 8x8, you manage to get until 1.6 gigabits per second through. Okay. For 16 QAM modulation, so these are all using the new novel 120 MHz. Okay. So 64 QAM 2x2 MIMO. You can see it's 806 megabits per second. Okay. Until 8x8, you can get around 3.2 gigabits per second throughput. Okay. Which means that more data can be transmitted and much faster for the system. Okay. So after presenting the result for 2x2, 4x4, and 8x8 for various modulation system, we can see that from all the output throughput, the best solution for this LTE is by using the 8x8 MIMO 64 QAM modulation technique, because this system can exceed into 4 gigabits per second, which I said just now. Initially it was 1 gigabits per second, and then we managed to get until 4 gigabits per second. And the throughput system has shown that 8 times 8 have managed to reach until 4 gigabits per second. This is for using a system view. This is just a compression. That's for using MATLAB. Okay, this is system view, and just to show that the results are almost the same with that system. Okay, for 60 megahertz, 80, 100, you can see almost the same. Of course, using system view, you can see the graph is a bit different from using a MATLAB output system. Okay, but you can just see that the plot of the graph is almost similar. This is 420. This is to show that a comparison between both of them. Second type of simulation, this is the continuous, that's for the downlink. So we have the 40 megahertz transmissions. You can see for 40 megahertz, you have two separate ones for this channel and one for that channel, which is equal to 2 times 2 times 20 megahertz. Okay. 60 megahertz, you get 3. Okay. 80, you get 4. Okay. 5 and 6. So this is almost similar. So in the end, what we want to see, the number of CC, okay, increased from 1, this is the LTE system until 5, we have managed to get 6. Transmission bandwidth, we increased to 120 MHz, and then the efficiency is same. Okay. So even though we increased until 120 MHz with 6 number of carrier application, we still maintain the efficiency to the 3.6 bits per second as what the LTE system wants. Okay. So that's the main contribution of it. Okay. So, and this is the data throughput. You can see if we manage to get until the 620, we get more data being transmitted out to the system. This is the comparison. The previous system LTE, before they moved to LTE advanced, okay. The previous system LTE is 1.4 to 20 megahertz, and then LTE Advanced 20 to 100. So that's what we propose, 20 to 120 megahertz. Okay. 300 megabits per second, LTE Advanced 1 giga. So we propose until 4 gigabits per second, by still keeping the same proposed LTE peak spectrum efficiency, 33.6 bits per second. Okay. But as I say, unfortunately, the band that we use is for band 41, okay, compared to LTE, which is band 1, and LTE 1 for band 40. Okay. Conclusion, okay, this research provides that we have reached 220 MHz, okay, keeping the same efficiency, and then we managed to upgrade throughout the throughput of the data rates. Okay. These are the publications that he managed to publish. Very active student, I think he managed to publish around 19, okay, papers. Every day keep sending me papers, please check, please check. And every day also keep asking me money, conference accepted, what to do. Okay, but of course, I did give him a scholarship, so he managed to balance up between sending conference and journal. Okay. This is the book that we have managed to publish. Lambert, okay, this is the book. Quite expensive, 70 pound. Okay. They did not even give us a free book. Okay. Author have to buy yourself, is it? Next time, don't send to this number. Okay. I have other publishers, they send us a copy, but yeah, this one, a bit stingy. They said, please buy. If you buy 5, they give you 1 free. So I have to. I did ask my library to buy, and they said, you buy 2 only. So I still cannot get the free because 5 only get 1 free. Okay. This one, published chapter. This one very good. They sent me a copy of the book. Okay. I think this one is a book in chapter by this program, Wireless Access Network 4G. Okay. So these are all the papers. By other authors or under this LTE advice, just on carrier education feature. These are some of the medals he won. He managed to, this is the competition inside the university. He managed to win a gold medal, and he got 400 ringgit Malaysia, which he did not share with me. I say it's alright, you can have it, okay. So this is a gold medal. These are some of the facility in our university. Okay, we have a good EMC lab, electromagnetic lab, And then we have this meat SRC if you want to replicate wafer and other things. Okay, so we have this we have a wireless communication. This is a system called Ionostrada. Okay. I'm not sure it's bleeping because it's asking me time's up, I think. So this is one of the Ionostrada where you can we can monitor the changes of molecules in the system. Okay. And below that is below the graph one is the GTM cell. The GTM cell is to check electromagnetic radiation from your mobile phones. Okay, if you bought a phone, you want to see how much radiation from it, you can put into this GTM cell. It will tell you how much radiation from your phone. Okay. So these are the equipments and all the facilities we have. Okay. So I welcome any from international. If you have did some marvelous test, I saw some have done circuit and then if you have not managed to test it, you can welcome to our unity and then we can try and test out to give you a better output for it. Okay. I think that's it. This is roughly my unity. That's the MOS. That one is the a night view of our in front of the lake. We have a faculty. Okay. So that's our main icon, the library 5 story and the activities for it. Okay. So thank you very much. I'm not sure you have any questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Faiz Abdullah. Any comment or any question?
So, I hope those who are doing PhD or study, this is something you need to achieve something like this, okay? Hopefully by end of your PhD, you manage to publish a well-written journal's paper, book in chapters, and if your work is hardware, then you can go for this innovation competition. It's a good thing, okay? Of course, getting medal, if you get gold medal, you don't get any value for it, okay? Our university always say, oh, we spend so much money sending you to innovation, you get gold medal. What do our university get? How to get commercial income? That's the main issue now. How to convert that gold medal into money coming in? Because a gold medal is just a gold medal, okay? So that's the concern of our university now. But it's a good recognition when you go to this competition, then people from industry can evaluate and see whether your product have good value or not. I think thank you for it this time.
Yeah, I just have a comment.
Yeah.
Although I'm not expert in this, you said that you know this testing software is very expensive.
Yeah.
But there is an open source MyRead or something like that.
For LTE, yeah. I don't think so. LTE.
Okay.
LTE, even MATLAB also, you know MATLAB you have Simulink.
Yeah.
Under Simulink also do not have the icon for LTE yet.
Okay.
So what my student did was to write the programming code. Okay? We were hoping one day to have the icon in Simulink that you can just put in the, plug in the blocks and then do the simulation. SystemU is expensive, I think 100K just for the whole package system.
Thank you so much, Dr. MFL Abdullah, for your keynote speech. Now, I would like to invite Kashif Hussain for his representing his paper ID number 68 and 69.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for joining me here today. I'll be presenting my paper that's regarding an optimization method. And because I worked on the fuzzy neural network, so I'm trying to optimize the fuzzy neural network. So let's have a look how we do. So it's basically accelerated Monte Carlo algorithm for classification problems. I'm trying to solve a classification problem through the help of fuzzy neural network. Basically, MindBlast algorithm is newly developed optimization method that has already outperformed the genetic algorithm and particle sum optimization and other their variants. I'm trying to improve this method to accelerate its convergence and the quality of optimization. MBA MindBlast algorithm, MBA, has already been improved by its own writer, the author. In 2012. They have named it improved MindBlast algorithm. I have improved furthermore, and I'm naming it accelerated MindBlast algorithm. So here's the outline. I'll be having a little bit of introduction and the concept of ANTHES. ANTHES is a type of fuzzy neural network. Then we'll be having a look at MindBlast algorithm, then the improved one version, and the proposed accelerated MindBlast algorithm, which is done in this paper. So we'll be in the end training ANTHES with the help of this optimizer and then figuring out the results. So fuzzy neural network, when it is integrated with fuzzy logic, when it is integrated with an artificial neural network, it creates fuzzy neural network. The purpose of fuzzy neural network is to give you the rules that can help you understand the logic, the results that have come up with the help of these rules. Artificial neural network is sort of a black box. When you give an input, it gives you output. It doesn't explain its decision. While the fuzzy neural network, when it is, I mean, the fuzzy logic, which is already the logic of creating fuzzy rules, when it is integrated with the fuzzy neural network, it can explain its decision with the help of evident rules. So what I'm doing is, ANTHES is basically a type of fuzzy neural network which has been implemented in various various classification, prediction, and other scientific problems. I'm trying to improve ANTHES with the help of MindBlast algorithm. How ANTHES works, it is basically a five-layer architecture. Its first layer is an input layer, and second layer is a membership function layer. And third layer is a normalization, and fourth is the linear polynomial equation to normalize the to construct the consequent part of the fuzzy rule. For example, if you see this, there is a rule. For example, if you see R1, R2, R3 are the fuzzy rules, and it has basically antecedent part and the consequent part, which is after then. After then is called the consequent part, and before, between if and then, this is called the premise or the condition. So the fourth layer is basically the consequent part, and fifth is the output. So this is how you can see fuzzy rule. The standard training method of ANTHES, it uses gradient method, which has certain drawbacks. It uses it has a two-pass algorithm. The standard training method of ANTHES has a two-pass algorithm, which uses gradient descent in the forward pass, which updates the consequent parameters, and in the forward pass, it uses least square method to update the consequent parameters. In the backward pass, it uses a gradient descent method to update membership function parameters. So now let's have a look at MBA, what MindBlast algorithm is. Basically, it is mimicking a process of blasting a mine. When you have certain mines spread all over in the minefield, when you blast a minefield, a bomb, then it explodes and the shrapnel pieces spread all over the area and hit other mines. So this way you have a sequence of explosions. So as one of our presenter explained a water drop algorithm that was also an optimization algorithm that was a certain of sequence of iterations. So it has iterations also in the term of explosions. So what you have to do is you have to find an optimal solution that is your objective function. That is basically could be any minimization or maximization function. So it uses three parameters: number of Schnapper pieces, exploration constant, and a reduction constant. So it has two phases. It first explores the search area, and after exploring the search area, it then exploits the particular towards a particular solution. So you have diversification in the exploration phase and intensification, or what you call it, more focused search in the exploitation phase. So in the first part, when you always start MBA with the first point shot, you can start with single short point. Also, you can start with multiple shots. So when you have an explosion, then you have this is basically exploitation phase. In the exploitation phase, you have the exploding part, and this is your direction and your distance, and you multiply it with the current location. Then you get the next location. Okay, and in the explore, this is how you explore it. This is distance and this is direction, and with the randomization, you are able to spread your shotgun pieces into different in different directions and with different distances. So what IMBA, which improved my velocity algorithm, did is basically it is replacing this part with this one. This is improving its convergence, and also it is taking the distance from of current best and the previous best. What I'm trying to do is I'm not taking the previous best. I'm taking the current best, current exploring location, and the current best location. So in optimization methods, when you go certain iterations, you always have a current best solution, and you're still looking for more better solution. So this is your current best solution, and this is your current solution. So in the next iteration, you're trying to produce some more intensified or more optimal solution. So this is my AMBA does. This is this algorithm. We first of all initialize AMBA, then initialize its parameters. Then this our stopping criteria is basically the maximum number of iterations. So these are the certain classification problems we solved in this particular experiment. There are certain data sets already available on the internet: Iris Flower, Banana, and Haselmans, and Hazelrope. So it has certain number of instances and certain number of inputs. So this is the specification of AMBA while solving. While training Ansys network. So this is how we improved. We improved the performance of MindPlus algorithm while training Ansys by, like, if you see our performance in case of IRISROTE, it is training in just 16 iterations, it is getting the maximum accuracy. So, and in other cases, like in Banana, in the same iterations, but still somehow some better accuracy by AMBA. Not very good in Banana, but in Hungarian, it's getting quite better. It's still in the 50 iterations, while in Hazelrope, we have just 24 iterations and still some best the accuracy. So this is how our AMBA performed in terms of accuracy and the number of iterations. So what is the purpose of improving an optimization algorithm is basically how you reduce the number of iterations. So how quickly your optimization algorithm is able to produce an optimal solution. So conclusion is AMBA is basically a variant of MindPlus algorithm. So AMBA reduces computation cost by eliminating the cost of maintaining previous best solution only. It uses the current best solution and the current candidate solution. AMBA trial helps for solving benchmark problems, classification problems. And it trained ANFIS with more accuracy and more efficiency as compared to MBA and IMBA. So this is how, thank you very much. So I would like to welcome the questions and comments from my work.
Any question, comment?
Most of the colleagues are from electronics. And I am having a great opportunity to meet a lot of Indians today. So very nice opportunity to.
Maybe again, I'll ask you, maybe a comment. You use neural networks with fuzzy logic.
Exactly.
Why not, if you know the outcome of the neural networks, mm-hmm. why not a fixed algorithm which is kind of a similar, which can mimic, you know, the idea of fuzzy logic? Well, what is the reason using the fuzzy?
Actually, fuzzy gives you the rules. The idea of fuzzy logic is giving you the rules.
Yeah.
Rules means if I make a certain decision, what is the rule behind my decision? I might have 200 rules, number of rules. And in the end, my decision is based on any of the 200 rules. So what I'm trying to do, when you use only artificial neural network, it doesn't have rules.
I'm not saying you should use only artificial network. Yeah. I'm saying where you have this block of fuzzy logic,
mm-hmm.
where it's kind of if and, you know, that sort of thing. If this happens,
yeah.
you know, then you yeah. have a rule.
Yeah,
right?
yeah. yeah.
So why not, if I know the outcome of the artificial neural networks,
mm-hmm.
for example,
mm-hmm.
if I know that these will be the outputs
mm-hmm.
of neural networks,
mm-hmm.
then why not using an algorithm which is